This episode of The Modern Rogue brought to you by NordVPN.
Go to nordvpn.com/rogue and get 75% off a 3-year plan. Use the code ROGUE.
That's a very big discount. $2.99 a month. Also, you know what? Heck, use that code, get a free month on us.
Look at him.
You're welcome.
Yeah. When you were a kid, did you ever create like your own language?
Yes, and I'm not proud of it.
Oh, really?
I came up with my own sign language.
Are you the Zodiac Killer?
No, me and my buddies figured out and be like, how about can, because this looks like a can you play today? That's a sunrise. Like, it's dumb. I was a dumb kid.
This is so much better than I thought. I want to learn it and try to communicate with
you. You.
Like the ape in Congo?
You.
Okay, Brian, how familiar are you with methods of encryption used during the Cold War?
Dr. James Grime, who talks to us about the Enigma Machine, truly random algorithmic encoding, and how it was cracked in part because they realized that you couldn't eliminate the human element, and in general, reports would probably end with the words Heil Hitler. So knowing that, that gave them a little bit of a clue to figure out the algorithm from there, and that's how Enigma got cracked. I know that there are book codes. I want to say that it was the Bible. Benedict Arnold used a book code where he would just send a bunch of numbers, and the idea was page whatever, paragraph whatever, word whatever, and then, but the Bible was the book that was the cipher to unlock everything.
But you had to have a specific version of the Bible and everything, and that's the key of it, is that both parties have to have the exact same thing that they're starting.
Correct, right.
And it's interesting that you say something about randomness, because that is the key to a lot of cryptography. What is truly random, right?
Right. Well, and even now, it's beguiling us when it comes to computer stuff. We are only able to do pseudo-random number generators on computers that still will have a bias to one side or the other. For example, you look at the spread of randomly generated numbers, and if it's perfectly even, that alone might be a bias. For example, in nature, normal distribution of numbers, the first digit in a number, whether it's the population of a city, the mass of a planet, area of the forest, length of a river, they all tend to start with a 1 most often, then a 2, then 3, then after that it falls off so starkly, but just in general those numbers tend to start with 1, 2, or 3.
Fascinating, because truly random numbers are hard to generate, right? You have to, in some cases, study like radioactive emissions to get truly random numbers based on the decay. But even RNGs included in common programming languages aren't truly random. They're based on algorithms that people are creating.
Right.
And so if you can find the patterns in those, the non-randomness, that greatly increases the enemy's ability to crack your code.
So one-time pads, if I remember correctly, the stories were that it was hard to get people to insist on actually doing a lottery style bingo, pulling out one thing, because the temptation is fill this in with a bunch of numbers. And then if you just use your mind to be like, I don't know, 6, 7, 5, 2, 6, 1, 1, that seems pretty random. We have a human bias that we would never think to go 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. But that might actually happen if you're truly randomly grabbing balls out of a bin.
Exactly, and so if you have a one-time pad, that is a very lo-fi method of communicating with someone in the field. One-time pads were used a lot during World War II. They came about in like the late 19th century, but they've been refined as everyone started to realize just how important truly random numbers were in cryptography.
So we talked a little bit about this on the number stations. What you want is the ability to say something out loud that the whole world can hear, but will only have meaning to one person. And so one-time pads are basically, theoretically, perfectly random collections of numbers and letters that act as a key, such that only two people have it in the world, and it's only active for a particular time or on a particular day at a particular appointment, and that both parties use it to encode and then decode and then destroy it. And then nobody has any frame of reference to figure out what was said.
Exactly. Now, the one-time pad key will look something like this, where we have a bunch of different messages. Now, I don't know who generated this or exactly how random these are. And again, the more random they are, the more airtight it's going to be. But you'll have a number of these messages, right? Now, you're only going to use one of these, and you're only going to use it once.
Okay, so forgive me, this doesn't look like a cipher. Are these actual messages that are encoded?
No, these are not messages. This is your key. When someone out in the field sends you a message, you're going to use your first key.
Okay.
And then once you've decoded that message that they sent you, you burn this.
Yeah, but how do I translate this random bunch of letters into something else?
Okay, we have a little cheat sheet here.
Okay.
Now, there's nothing special about this, right? It's just an alphanumeric grid. You've got A through 9 here, and then A through 9 going vertically as
sure.
well. This is just to help you decrypt. Here's a message I have for you.
Right.
Using this key.
The very first one, message one.
Exactly. Now, this key, you have to have a copy, and I have to have a copy.
Correct.
No one else should have a copy, right? And so the trickiest part to this entire thing is getting this to you and making sure that it's not intercepted.
Okay.
Because if it's intercepted, it's done,
sure.
right?
Oh, I get it. So since we have this grid that's A through 9, and this grid that's A through 9,
right.
and this is all laid out, my guess is we combine what you send me with what I know.
So exactly. You got to start from the right side in the right direction, right? So here, you're going to start with D, because your first one here on your first message is D.
Got it. So you begin with the one-time pad.
So you've got your D here, and then go over to J here, actually.
Oh, that's not what I thought at all.
Yeah,
okay.
Because if you look, this one has a little handy sending and receiving code right here.
I see. So this is the code. We go to the input, and then we go up, and what we find is the letter. So in this case, first letter has to be G.
Correct.
Okay,
the L.
From the next one, and we go down to L, and then we're gonna go over to the next part of our message, which is 2. Then I go up, and it's R.
Correct.
Right, okay, there you go. To I, Grimey, Frank Grimey Grimes? You.
I think I made this one too easy.
I go up, I get L. Oh, dude.
Right?
All right, hold on.
You just got order 66, my friend.
And then there's another L. All right, it's clearly grilled cheese.
Correct. Take a look at this and note what I think is kind of remarkable about it, about such a really pretty simple cipher, right?
Yeah, sure.
We've got J2VUOS. And so we've got L.
And then L again.
And then L for an O. And then you've got a double E, because double letters, whenever you're cracking a cipher, double letters or something, or
those are big clues.
Letters, those are big clues, but in this case, it doesn't work because you've got two E's represented by a G and then a 2.
And you didn't even have to be clever and say like, well, I'm gonna use a different way to do an L this time. You just followed the algorithm and you got what looks like total random nonsense in order to produce that.
Exactly. Now you have cracked this one using grilled cheese. So this right here
is now burned.
This is done. The guy broadcasting the encoded message to you over a number station and everything, he will destroy this and you will destroy this. Next time you get a message from him, you use this. It's crucial, again, that this is random, that no one gets their hands on this, and that you do not reuse this.
Dude, that's fantastic. This is a diabolical solution that does seem to have some limitations. Both parties have to have the exact same one-time pad. They have to be synchronized. If either party has their pad copied or stolen, then you're gonna have a bad day. I suppose also you're fighting the fact that the one-time pad, it has to be absolutely crucial that it's truly random. You can't rely on any human biases.
Well, listen, all codes are built by people, right? And so they're only as airtight as the person who defined it. Even if it's generated by a computer, it's using an algorithm that was written by a person. So there's going to be problems with it, but this is still one of the easiest, most lo-fi and airtight ones that you can find. And what I love about it is that anybody can do it. We just did it right now over the course of like 10 minutes. I think we should build a secret communication network.
That sounds like work, but yes, fine, fine. They'll all say grilled cheese.
Yeah,
Illuminati
exactly.
Confirmed.
The Grilled Cheese Association.
Hearthstone.
It's all just Hearthstone tips.
Shh.
Our entire secret network.
Shh, you're going to ruin my new podcast. Stop.
Brian, you have a new experience with Nord. You want to talk about it? Let's talk about it. We get here. We come out here on the deck and we just talk about Nord sometimes.
So I usually read my news from Google News. That's the first thing I check every day.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't realize that it categorizes that to your location,
yes,
right?
Yes, it does.
So because I'm like, attach me somewhere. And sometimes the fastest server is like in England is what it was this morning. So I saw all of the American news through the lens of people living in England. They keep saying like, what? candidate Jeep Jop says about Donald Trump? And I'm like, who's candidate Jeep Jop? And I realized that they have elections out in England.
They do.
It was amazing to like be automatically fed news from a totally different perspective.
Yeah, you don't have to hunt for it. You just select and say, oh, I'm from this part of the globe. And it says, okay, here's what your internet experience is like when you're in Scotland, when you're in Iceland, when you're in South America.
It's fantastic. And plus, there's, of course, the security stuff. The only VPN to get 5 out of 5, perfect score at PC Mag.
It got through the Great Wall of China. That's not even right.
The Great Firewall of China. I was about to say, you're thinking of David Copperfield.
Yeah, that's what it is, yeah. So go to nordvpn.com/rogue, that's R-O-G-U-E, and get 75% off a 3-year plan. That's $2.99 per month. And
use that URL and you get an extra month free. How about that?
How can you say no?
Pretty rad, right?
Don't even tell me
who's
if you're gonna
say no.
Who's
super cool? Who's your hookup? Come on. Who loves some VPNs?
And NordVPN.
Privacy.
And NordVPN.
Just keep you doing you.
Yeah. We got you.
Yeah.
Take your clothes off.
God damn.
It feels good.
It's
you can just surf.
It's
not have to
the
worry
internet.
About a thing.
It's not appropriate.
I do
it's
it.
It's not gonna be good.
In my own home. I mean, in Starbucks. Not the same Starbucks. It's gonna be kicked out. Okay, it's a bus station. It's a bus station. Truth time.